When you create a program, how does it remember things? Last time, we created a variable and put our name inside, but where was our name actually stored? Jumping into memory already might seem a little unusual. A lot of programming tutorials in any language would like to get you writing a bit of code before you have to worry about such things. However, I think right off the bat, we actually have a wonderful opportunity to talk about how memory works in Rust, and because memory is so important to how Rust works, learning this is going to simplify everything else going forward. Today, we're going to make an extremely simple program and use that as a basis to explain how Rust remembers. This series has a free accompanying book in which you can find all the details for this tutorial. Check the description below. My name is Daniel. Welcome to Iris. To learn about memory, we'll make a simplified version of the guessing game from the official Rust book. Start by opening your terminal and navigating to wherever you create your projects, just like last time. Then, we'll create a new project with Cargo New Guessing Game. We'll open up the project and go to the file main.rs. As before, we'll see the same Hello World program. Let's quickly change our Hello World message to something that welcomes the user to the game. And then we're going to add another print line that tells the user what to expect. Let's pick a color that the user has to guess. I'm going to pick blue, but feel free to pick your favorite color. Before we move on, I want to talk about the type of the data we just created. We're going to cover types properly in the next video, but I want to quickly point out just a few things. The type of the data describes a number of things, but mainly how the data is represented in memory and how it can be used. For example, is the data a string like blue or a number or a boolean that represents true or false? As you can see, my editor has written colon ampersand stra after actual. This isn't part of the text, it's just there to show me the type of the variable. This means that the variable actually contains a reference represented by the ampersand to a string slice represented by stra. We'll talk about why the variable only contains a reference to the data and not the data itself later. You could, if you like, write this in manually, but it's generally better to let Rust infer the type and only write it yourself if either Rust is unable to decide, because it could be multiple things, or in the case that Rust has a default type and you want to use something different. Anyway, back to the program. Let's output the color so that we can see that the program is working okay. Great, but not much of a game, is it? You don't even really have time to guess the color before you're told what it is. Before we tell the user what the actual color was, let's ask them to guess. In order to get some user input, we need to read it from the terminal. When the program runs in the terminal, we can ask the user to type things in. Regardless of whether you're on Windows, Mac, or Linux, this input is passed into the program through a stream of data called standardin. Rust comes with a standard library. The name is unrelated to the stream, they just both happen to be standard. We can access the standard library through a module called std. I always pronounce this std, but I think most people say stud, and I should really start doing that. Modules in Rust are a way of grouping up other bits of code, such as functions, data types, other modules, etc. Inside of this is another module called IO that deals with input and output. If we weren't using the println function, this is where we'd have to come to write things out to the terminal too via a stream called standardout. Println is a nice little wrapper that makes writing to standardout very trivial. For completion's sake, I should mention that in addition to standardin and standardout, there is one more stream called standarderror. This is also an output stream that we can use to separate informational output that is not part of the normal use of a program, whether that's errors or just information that's not directly relevant to the main output. Standard error is really useful for things like logging, which we'll talk about in the future, but if you want to quickly write something to the output stream, you can just use eprintline and eprint, the same way that we use println and print. So we get standard in using stud io standard in. This is a function call. We'll talk more about functions in two videos' time, that returns something called a handle that we can use for memory access to the input stream. The double colons just tell Rust that we're looking for something inside a module. We're going to cover modules in detail later, including how, why, and when to make our own, as well as better ways to access them. Since we only need to write this line one time, this is the easiest way to do it. We could store the result of standardin in a variable. However, we only need to use the handle once and then we're done with it. So straight off the back of it, we can just call lines. This is a method, a special type of function that specifically belongs to some other thing. In this case, it belongs to the handle for standardin. Lines returns an iterator, allowing us to iterate or step through each line one at a time. We can get the next line by calling next on the iterator. Wait. What are all these expects about? Expect is, I would say, the second worst way you can handle something going wrong in your program. This is not idiomatic, and you should certainly not use this in anything except the most throwaway software, as it will immediately stop your program and spew a lot of information to the user. In the future, we're going to talk about things going wrong and how to handle them better. However, as this program is just for you, I think you're going to cope with this for now. That doesn't explain what these lines are doing or why there are two of them. The reason for this is there are two possible ways lines might not work for us. So, the first expect then, where we say no input was read. When we call next on any iterator, there either is something next or there isn't. In some languages, this concept of something or nothing might be represented as either the data you wanted or null. For example, in another language we might ask for a string and get read or null. Now, read is a string, but null is not. So what happens if you try to use the return value as if it were a string? In languages with this behavior, it might produce an error at the point where the data is used, not where it was generated. So you have to make sure you always check that your data is what it's supposed to be, which the language is not making an effort to remind you to do. Obviously, many people think this ambiguity is bad, including Tony Hoare, arguably the inventor of this behavior. He called it his billion-dollar mistake. Rust doesn't let you use types like this interchangeably, so data cannot be a string or null because these types are not compatible. Instead, a function that could return something or nothing will return an option. Option is an enum, meaning its value is one of a set of variants. In this case, the variant is either sum or none, and if the variant of the option is sum, then it also contains our value. Otherwise, it doesn't. Importantly, when a function returns an option type, you, the programmer, must check to see if it contains some data and then extract that data if it's there. There are a number of ways to do this, and expect is one of the worst. It will attempt to extract the data immediately if it's there, or stop the program abruptly with the provided error message if it's not. We'll talk about better ways to handle this in the future. For the time being, we're just going to say that we can't deal with the data not being there. We don't want to continue running the program, and we want the program to stop immediately. We use expect message to say if this is nothing, we are giving up. Stop the program and print our message, plus a few other useful bits to standard error. You can see why this behavior is typically undesirable, but we can allow it for this example, at least until we learn how to properly deal with option. The second expect is a little bit different. You see, if the option we got from next contains something instead of nothing, it still doesn't necessarily contain the data that we wanted to read. Reading data from standard in itself is fallible. Fallibility, the nature that something may go wrong in programming, is another thing we've traditionally handled very badly. A common way to deal with this in other programming languages is to stop execution and throw an error. The problem with throwing errors is that it breaks the flow of execution. Normally, code is executed one line after another. Once an error is thrown, though, the next thing to get executed after the throw is not obvious. It's going to be wherever the error is caught, if it's caught. Sometimes you may not even realize that some of your code could throw an error because you've called someone else's code and they didn't make it obvious that their code was fallible. Rust does away with this with another enum type called result. If your function could fail, it must return a result type. Like with option, result is its own type that contains either the data we wanted or an error. The idiomatic way to handle result types depends on what you're trying to do. Could you recover from the error and keep going? How do you want to report the error back to the user, etc.? Using expect will, again, cause the program to immediately stop with the error message sent to standard error. And again, you can see why this is typically extremely undesirable. For now, we'll make do with the two expects, and we have a working program. There is an actual color, the user guesses a color, and we print both to the screen. Okay, to the meat of today's video then. You might have spotted that actual and input have different types. Don't worry if you didn't spot that. When we added the code associated with getting the input, it added a lot of type information, so you might have missed it. Importantly though, actual is a reference to a string slice. However, input is a capital S string. What's the difference? To understand this, we have to talk a little bit about how our program runs. In Rust, like many languages in fact, programs are made up of functions, small independent bits of code. In our program, we only actually have one function for now, which is main, but this next bit still applies. When we run our program, the operating system assigns some memory for the program to run in called the stack. Functions can call other functions, and each time we go into a new function, we create a block of memory on the stack that is the exact size of everything that that function needs to remember. For example, imagine the following program with the functions main, f1, and f2. When the program is initialized, the operating system assigns some memory for the stack. Then, all the memory required to store all the variables in main, which in this example is say 4 addresses, is blocked off. Then, as main runs, it calls f1, which requires 2 more addresses. A new block with space for those variables is put onto the stack. F1 then calls the function f2, which requires 3 more addresses worth of memory. We create another block and that goes on top of the stack. Once f2 is finished, it's removed from the stack. Then f1 finishes and it too is removed from the stack. Finally, main comes to an end and our program closes and all the memory is freed. You can see that the amount of memory a function needs is very important, but how long is a piece of string? How much space does a string take in memory? Our 3 colors, red, blue, and green, are 3 characters, 4 characters, and 5 characters respectively. How much memory should we assign on the stack? What about the user's input? That could be 3 characters, 4 characters, or the complete works of Shakespeare. How much memory each function requires is decided at build time, and we don't know what the user is going to write until later. Anything that lives inside a variable goes on the stack, and anything on the stack must be of known size when the program is compiled. In Rust, we have a specific name for this. Sized. Things like numbers, characters, and booleans are sized, but a string of characters is not. It is unsized. Where does the data live if not inside a variable? Returning to the top, you'll remember that our actual variable has the type ampersand struct. The ampersand tells us that the value is a reference, and the struct tells us that it is a reference to a string slice. A reference is something that points to where the actual data is. This is very handy if you want to be able to tell something about some data without having to give it the actual data. When you manually write a string between 2 double quotes like this, it's called a string literal. This applies to our variable as well as every time we've used it in a print line. String literals are hard-coded into the binary file that we create when we compile the program. In our case, that's an executable file that gets run. A string slice can be any part of a string that's stored somewhere else. So it can be the characters 0 to 3, BLUE, of our string literal, wherever it is in the executable file. Our input, however, is very different. We don't know what's going to be in here at all at compile time. In order to store the data that the user gives us, we still need to put it in memory somewhere, but it can't live on the stack or in the binary. Instead, we use another kind of memory called the heap. At any point while the program is running, we can ask the operating system to allow us access to some amount of memory. We still need to know how much memory we need, but now we only need to know at runtime. This memory comes from the heap. In the heap, we can store unsized data, as well as sized, which can be useful in certain circumstances. And then, because everything about the location of the data is sized, we can store that on the stack.
Input
doesn't contain the data, but it does know where the data is. Some other important differences between the stack and the heap. The stack is more limited in size. You should try to avoid storing large amounts of data in here. However, creating memory on the heap takes a little bit longer than creating it on the stack. This is because you have to communicate your requirements to the operating system and wait for it to get back to you with that allocation. This doesn't take so long that you're going to notice unless you do it a lot. Okay, this is all great, but why is one of them a string slice and one of them a string if both of them are just references to the data stored elsewhere? This actually comes down to ownership. Now, we'll go into ownership in more detail in a later video, but at a very high level, a reference to a string does not own the string data, whereas a capital S string owns it, and therefore it has full control over it. Most importantly, ownership tells the program when to clean up the data. When a string reference is no longer needed, the reference is cleaned up, but the data still exists. When a string is no longer needed, not only is the reference cleaned up, but the memory where the string data was stored is also returned back to the operating system's control, freeing it up for something else to use. It's important to know, though, that a reference to a string slice and a string are different types. The data they reference is formatted the same way in memory, but they are not interchangeable. Later, when we discuss functions, you'll see that if a function requires a string, you cannot pass it a string slice and vice versa. However, you can trivially convert between them. For example, we could turn our actual variable into a string by creating a new string from that data. And we can get a reference to the string slice inside of the string back again. That said, Rust will let you compare any two types of data so long as someone has told Rust how to do the comparison, which for strings and string slices, someone has. Let's return to our program one last time and we'll add a branch to our code. If else is a form of flow control that allows us to do one thing if the expression we put into the if evaluates to true and something else if it doesn't. So if input is equal to actual, we'll print you win, else we'll print you lose. Today we learned specifically about the stack and the heap. The stack is where variables live. Data must be of known size at compile time, as in sized, but access is very fast. The heap, however, is where we can store things regardless of whether we know their size at compile time, sized or unsized. We can store large amounts of data here, but getting access to this memory initially is a tiny bit slower. You can reference data if you don't want ownership of that data, but you do want access to it. We learned a bit about option and result, which we'll go into more in the next video and future videos too. Finally, we touched on controlling the flow of execution with if. However, this isn't the only way we can affect the flow, and we'll talk more about this in two videos' time. Okay, this has nothing to do with today's topic, and I'm not going to go too deep into anything, but I couldn't leave you with a guessing game that isn't really a game. If we want to randomize the actual value, we can create an array of all the possible values. An array is a list of things of the same type, separated by commas and surrounded by square brackets. Arrays are sized, but they cannot have their size change at runtime. There are other types of doing that. We can fake randomness by getting a big number that will change every time we run the program, like the time. The Unix epoch was midnight on the 1st of January 1970. We can find out how much time has passed since then and then get that time in milliseconds. We need to do a quick type conversion, which we'll talk more about next time. This just lets us use the number of milliseconds to access the array. This conversion could truncate the data, but it doesn't matter in our case. Finally, we can find the remainder after dividing by the length of the array by using the remainder operator. This gives us a random-ish index into the array. Now when you run the program, you won't know what the actual color is. Next time, we're going to look more at data types. We'll look at the primitive or scalar types, how we can create complex types with enums and structs, how we can create more flexible types with generics, and I'll introduce you to a few of the built-in collection types. If that interests you, don't forget to like and subscribe. In the meantime, have a play with your program, and I'll see you next time. Oh no, there's a cat! Yuki! Buddy. You causing me the problems? Meow. What's up? Meow. You were in the last video, weren't you? You're not going to be in this one, I'm afraid. Don't give me that look. Talk to your agent. What do you mean I'm your agent?